Welcome to the final episode in our Hearts of Wulin series, everyone. We get into some great discussion about this game in this episode, but first, a few announcements as usual. It has been an absolutely busy week for me this week, so it's just me again, so let's get to it. First up, since last episode, Hearts of Wulin is now on Kickstarter. If you are excited about backing this game, you can go to kickstarter.com and search for Hearts of Wulin, or find the link in our show notes. They've already blown past funding and a few stretch goals, so now is the time to see if we can get them a few more stretch goals to add even more content to this amazing game. Next, it's that time of year again. GenCon is right around the corner, it seems. And just yesterday, event registration opened up. We happen to have a panel that we are hosting with James D'Amato to help lead Amelia and myself through some character building exercises with a couple of the characters that we made on this show. If you were able to hear our Acaticon panel, you'll have an idea of what this panel will entail, and I can't wait to reveal which characters we've decided on fleshing out this time. We'll have a link to the panel in the show notes in case you'd like to get tickets, since we have plenty of tickets available for this event. And speaking of Gen Con, Amelia's game of L5R appears to be sold out as of right now. But my games of Chimera have not been posted yet. We are working to see what is going on there, but as soon as those become available, I'm sure we will let everyone know through our social media and announcements on the show here as well. There's plenty of time, so hopefully soon. And one last announcement, which I am very excited about. Amelia will be back next week. We are working on recording the next episode while juggling everything else in life. But it will be really great to have her back with us again. That's not to say that our guest co-hosts weren't phenomenal. I greatly enjoyed my time chatting with both Marie Claire and Adira. But for now, let's close out this cold open, sit back, relax, and hear a bit more about Hearts of Wulin by Lowell Francis and Agatha Cheng. Enjoy!
Welcome back to our discussion episode. Last time, we created a group of characters for Hearts of Wulin. This episode, we will be discussing the character creation process. We are very excited to welcome back Agatha Cheng and Lowell Francis, the creators of this very game. Agatha, do you want to go ahead and introduce yourself again for everyone at home and tell us a little bit about the character you made in our last episode?
Yeah, I am the co-author of Hearts of Wulin, and I'm also the co-host of Asians Represent, another podcast on the One Shot Network, where we celebrate diversity from an Asian perspective by interviewing Asian creators within the analog gaming community and also running actual plays. Right now it is of masks. And the character that I created is called Xianghui. He is a monk. His playbook is student and background is wandering monk, so briefly describe what he looks like. He's handsome. This is further down on the list, but it's the one I remember the most. He's handsome. He has a crooked smile. He is tanned from doing a lot of work outside. He doesn't know that he's handsome. And he also wears normal temple clothes, but with bells. And again, those bells are at the bottom of his clothes and also on his wrists and his ankles. And this ties in with his sick... I remember this is a family-friendly podcast. So his sick fighting style, which is called the 10-pointed cage. And again, his style element associated with it is fire. So it's a very fast style where he walks in this formation where there are 10 points, and when he walks, the bells on him, they will ring, and depending on how fast he goes, or where the hearer is in relation to him, they'll be at different pitches. And because he's so fast, it seems like all the bells are ringing at once, and that creates this 10-pointed cage that traps the listener or his opponent in it and inflicts various amounts of damage.
And that's awesome.
Yeah. So that's kind of him. He's pretty cheerful, kind of well-meaning, and he tends to like people more than he would dislike them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. And Lowell, how about yourself? Can you tell us a bit more about yourself and your character that you created?
My name is Lowell Francis, and I'm also the co-author of Hearts of Wulin, and I'm the co-host of the Gauntlet podcast, which is part of the sort of Gauntlet bigger network of things that are going on. I'm kind of the RPG hangout coordinator for the whole community. I run 3 games a week that we record for actual play on there. And that's sort of my story. I'm also a blog at Age of Ravens, which won an Emmy back in 2017, and is now part of the Gauntlet blog on Wednesdays. And so my character. So my character is 7th century Zhu, and I think his faction, I called it the Iron Prosperity Delegates. I stole that from my sample name list, which is great. And he is a loyal playbook of the official role. He used to be like a magistrate, but kind of secretly working for the emperor and, you know, hunting dissidents within the Wulin factions. But then he got betrayed. And he's left that. He's kind of gone back to the other factions to try and return to his regular life. But he's kind of potentially distrusted by some. He is, as all of us are, handsome, beautiful, burning eyes, kind of wears formal clothes, hair tightly bound. I mentioned that he looks a little pallid. You can see that he has been sick recently. There was an illness or poisoning he's still not sure that nearly killed him that he hasn't quite recovered from. His fighting style is the limitless character brush. He fights with a large iron brush, like for calligraphy or writing, and it has the sort of brush tip at the end. It's heavy, so he can strike with it or spin it or parry with it, but he can also use it to mark an opponent should he choose to go that route. And that is an earth style, about kind of a caution and focus. And so I have the magistrate move, and I have a couple of others that are about hunting and people down, and also about supporting other characters. And my character pretty much is certain that they are a good person, really, at heart, but there are certain evidence to the contrary on that, not least of which is I am potentially stepping out on Agatha's character's sister, who I'm married to, and I have other issues with a rival and so on.
But how would you be doing that? I'm in love with you. I think you're the best.
Too bad. So that's who 7th century Zhu is.
Are you basically like the opposite of Andy Lau's character in what is the English name of that? The film we just watched.
House of Flying Daggers?
Yeah.
Oh,
great. I hope I'm not inspired by that guy, because that guy was awful. So
Yeah.
He's, oh, what a, ugh. Yeah. No, well, I'm actually good. Really. Really. So that's my character.
That's amazing.
Well, while the jury's out on that, Ryan, why don't you tell us about your character?
All right. My character refers to himself as Perfected Fist. a name that he gave himself after he discovered his extraordinary powers of fighting with his fists. And he is part of the self-proclaimed Society of the Smoldering Crater, which is a society that he makes up wherever he goes and tells people that it's this big thing when it's literally just him bragging about a society that doesn't really exist, but nobody really knows that. And maybe he wants to build up a following based on his awesomeness. I'm not sure yet. But he's unassuming. He's kind of on the smaller side. He's pretty petite. And his hair is always unkempt. He wears modest clothing and stuff, but he's got an unflinching gaze due to his confidence. And he's got his arms bared, even though they're really scrawny and not muscular at all. He bears his arms because he knows that his arms and his fists are his greatest asset, and he believes that they are much nicer looking than they actually are. And he also has hopeful eyes. So when you are talking to him casually, you'll see a little bit of hope for the future in his eyes, which tells of a little bit of more of a depth to him than this, like, exterior of I'm the best. His fighting style is called Smoldering Crater, because which is fire-based, because when he unleashes his power, it creates an explosion after he punches somebody, which leaves a smoldering crater in the ground, and the person that was there probably gets knocked back. I'm not sure if disintegrating foes is a wuxia staple or not, but maybe that can happen at some point too. I don't know. But yeah, he's just wanting to fulfill his kind of the prophecy that he thinks he is part of. So hopefully with this group of individuals that he found, he can finally reach his destiny. And what about yourself, Adira?
So my character is Black Petal. She is a member of the Peony Society, who I have established all have flower-related names. Black Petal, like everyone, is smoking hot. She has long and flowing locks, stormy eyes, a stern grin, and an intricately patterned outfit. It's a pattern of tight and complicated and overlapping geometries that when you look closer is little made up of little stitched petals. Black Petal herself is stoic yet flirtatious. She prefers to keep her emotions pretty close to her chest, but will sort of mask that by sort of playing out with other people. Her fighting style is the Broken Mountain style, where Black Petal uses a massive sledgehammer. I'm thinking like multiple feet tall sledgehammer, which she moves around effortlessly. But the style is about doing hard and deliberate and decisive movements, just slamming it down. And it's associated with the element of metal. Black Petal herself has the prophecy that says that she's supposed to be with Perfected Fist, but sort of deals a lot with playing around with some of 7th Century Zhu's emotions as well, and all of these different people. She is a lot of fun, I feel like. Yeah.
That's awesome. All right. Well, now that we know who we made, let's go ahead and dive right into a segment we are calling D20 for Your Thoughts.
D20 for Your Thoughts?
Okay. So in this segment, we want to talk to our guests about their thoughts on the character creation process and how it feels in this system compared to others. But first, we really want to find out how both of you got into role-playing games in the first place.
Lowell?
Who wants to start?
Assume you, Lowell, have a longer story than
me. Yeah, unfortunately, I do. So this is going to be one of those grognardy things, and I'm going to apologize ahead of time.
You don't need to apologize?
So My sister is Kat Rambo, a writer who's actually president of the Science Fiction Writers of America, SFWA. And back in 1975, my dad came back from Ann Arbor, Michigan with a copy of the original D&D box set and gave it to my sister for Christmas. And a couple months later, she was like, "You got to try this game." And she showed me the game because she's 5 years older than me. And I made up a hobbit because I liked hobbits. And I killed a giant rat. And she said, "You going to cut the rat open to see if there's anything in it?" And I was like, "Yes, yes." And there was. And that was all it. It was a gem inside. And that was, I wanted to play this game all the time then. And I think I've pretty much been playing RPGs constantly with only a couple of a break for grad school. And that is it. I've been playing ever since and running since I was in grade school, and I love it. And so that's how I've rolled up into this. My wife married me because I'm a good GM, as she's told people, and that's how that works.
That's awesome.
Wow. I don't have a D&D story. No, actually, I do. Oh, all right. Well, I think the first time that I remember I started playing, my first role-playing game was Dungeons & Dragons 4th Ed. No, was it 4th Ed? I don't remember anymore. It was with a couple of people from a church that I was going to, and it was fun. I didn't understand what was going on. And the second time I went to play with them, they were like, that campaign ended, so now we're playing Pathfinder. And we have a party, so you get to play a gnome bard. And I was like, ? I didn't understand what was actually going on throughout the whole session. They were talking a lot about line of sight, which is what I recall from, this is the only thing that I understand about Pathfinder, which is line of sight.
It's important.
Apparently. Yeah. And, I mean, I feel like at that point I was like, there's something in here that I really enjoy. I think I'm going to keep looking. And so I went to play with, I Googled role-playing game Toronto because this is where I live. And then I found the Toronto Area Gamers, which is run by Kate Bullock, Rach Shelkey, and Rob Dibbled. It was at that point. And then I played one of my first games with Kate, and where she was running this, like, it was a tarot card based system that I don't remember the name of anymore. And it was really hectic and we all almost died. And I was like, this is so scary. I'm so scared of Kate as a GM, but I love it. And then I think I never looked back since then. This was around 3 or 4 years ago. Okay. And then, yeah, I most of my role playing has actually been with a Gauntlet. I joined it around a year ago, and I was like, oh, I love it. And that's where I got all my experience, realistically speaking.
Oh, very cool. All right. Can you tell us then about your personal processes for picking and creating characters in any role-playing game system?
Ooh, that's a great question. I'm very curious about your process, Lowell.
So there are two factors that I have in this. One is that I look and I see at the table whether there's anybody who looks like they are going to take charge. Like, if there's a player who looks like they are going to be taking charge and stuff, then I'm like, great. And then I love making a support character, and I will make a support character. However, if it's clear to me that no one is going to take charge, like they're all going to be wishy-washy, then I will make a character who's going to take charge because I want to get things moving. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of my first sort of decision-making thing about what's going on. And that's usually when we get to the process, I'm like, okay, what is everybody going to play? And they're all like, oh, I was going to do this or this. And if that lasts for more than 10 minutes, then I know we've kind of got a maybe less directed group. Mm-hmm. But I love playing support. But the other thing I do is I try to look back at the last character that I made, and whatever I make with this new character should be the opposite of something from the last character. Should be contradictory. Like, so the last Hearts of Wulin character I made was a younger sibling, very loyal, very gentle, very kind of naive about the world and so on. So I wanted a character that was much more world weary and not cynical about things. So that was my kind of flip on that. And I think those are the two things I really think about. If there's a system for magic with like spells and things like that, yeah, I avoid that like a hot potato. Do not do crunchy magic systems. Ours magic, it was hard. Yeah. but I did that. But otherwise, I try to do characters that are pretty simple.
That's awesome. How about yourself, Agatha?
Yeah, I think for me as well, if it's a crunchier system, and by crunchy, I'm definitely speaking from a very story game perspective. So anything that is... So, for example, for me, D&D is pretty crunchy. I will ask someone, what's the easiest thing to play? And they'll usually say, warrior/fighter/something like that. And I'll say, okay, tell me, I'll pick a big weapon. So that's that's my usual go-to for that. I don't understand magic. I was not steeped in that kind of system, so... I stay away as well. And then for other stuff, I really like what you said about going against, like, not against, but yeah, it's choosing something that is pretty far from the last character you played. And I think I do the same without realizing. For me, a lot of times when I'm playing these games, I'm engaging with genres that I'm not super familiar with, even like high fantasy and stuff like that. Like a lot of times I Lord of the Rings is kind of a touchstone, but that's it. So I like reading through the playbooks and then seeing an aspect of it that I can engage with, and it's usually some kind of like, I think if through reading the moves and the backgrounds I think I can empathize with this character, then it's hard to describe like what really stands out sometimes. So like even, yeah, but it's usually if I can empathize, and I really like playing characters that have I have a tendency of playing characters that have the hold to very strong beliefs that are very problematic, but they, mm-hmm. and they're sometimes they're very harmful to the character themselves, but they believe it and they don't think it's wrong. And and it's interesting because every single time I play those kind of characters, everyone else has just like, no one else has pointed that problem out to the characters I played. No one has been like, you know, that, for example, in this Monster Hearts game, you know that you're in like an abusive relationship, right? Like, this is terrible, but no, everyone's got their own problems. Ain't nobody gotta deal with mine. Yep. And so I think that's sometimes what I like to gravitate towards. I also really like playing sassy teenage girls. That's just, so if I have an option of doing that, and I haven't done that in a while, I will default to that.
Awesome.
So how do we think about character creation in this game stacking up to other systems that we've played?
This will be a question for all of us.
It's a PBTA style playbook approach. So mm-hmm. it's very much on that. And we've tried to break it down into pretty easily digestible chunks. I try to avoid having to mix and match playbooks, which is something that can sometimes get confusing for me. I tried to keep it tight. I mean, because I run a lot, everything for me is about how do I keep it simple when we go mm-hmm. to do it. I want to be able to sit down, because I run 2.5-3 hours online. That's yeah. my session. So I want to get character creation done in at most 1 hour and 15 minutes. I want that us to sense. Do that, get it done. We take our break, we come back. Mm-hmm. And I can do that. And I can do that online. I can do that at the table. And I think our setup, our approach is doable within that time limit with explanations mm-hmm. and safety tools and all of that.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. I know the game that I'm working on, also PBTA, takes about 1.5 hours for character and world building mm-hmm. Creation. And so that seems to line up really well with most convention, like one-shot type spaces.
Yeah, yeah.
3 to 4 hour games. I liked the entanglement system in this a lot. Most PBTA games, like every playbook says, this is your bond, fill it in. And you don't really get a choice of what type of bond you want because it's geared towards that particular playbook, which is which is fine, but it's really cool that here you've got a few suggestions for the playbook that you choose, but also, like, if those don't work for you, you got this list. And there's going to be something in there that really will catch your eye and kind of drive your character story forward in ways that most other PBT games that I've played haven't really done in that way.
There's that really hard design space choice between giving players too much freedom and overwhelming them. That is, and still finding that, you know, yeah. Trying to find that sweet spot. But I definitely want to give people more choice about what they want to do, because I've looked at like sometimes at Masks or other games and I'm like, ugh, none of these really work, or I'm going to have to really fiddle around mm-hmm. with how this is to get it to work to what I'm thinking.
Right.
I think that you guys really accomplished the freedom, not feeling like there's ever like a wrong choice very mm-hmm. well. Like, there are a bunch of different moves and all the different stats and things like that, that sometimes, even in like a Powered by the Apocalypse story game sort of thing, it can feel like, oh, playing a character like this that doesn't have that move, that's a wrong choice to make. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't feel like that with this. Like, since you're doing the approach-based stats, everything's really fluid in there, that it's like, oh, just sort of, what do I want to do? This is sort of how I want to deal with this. This is the right choice then, because it's the choice I want to make. That this system seems to accomplish that very well, because freedom can sometimes be limiting when you're like, wait a second, but what is like the right choice? Mm.
It's a design choice that cuts out a bunch of moves, though. It's interesting because it cuts out the roll this instead of this moves. Mm-hmm. And the way we've set up study cuts out add these questions on moves. And it also cuts out any add plus one to this stat, you know, advance or move. So it forces us to be, you know, creative about what we do have there.
Yeah, for sure. I really like all the different moves that you have in the playbooks. And when I was thinking of my character concept, I was basing it off of the very general, like, this is kind of what a prodigy is. And then I was pleased when I saw the moves that lined up perfectly with exactly what I was kind of going for my character. So I thought that was really cool.
Yeah. And a lot of these moves, some of these, I think the basic moves you can see, oh yeah, like these are taken from other PBTA games, which they would have to be. For example, like, again, the study move, it's just kind of one of those basic things that needs to happen, though with a special exception, which is that instead of just asking questions when you roll, you can actually spend the hold that you generate from your roll to make a statement about the scene, and that statement, or declare a detail, if you will, and that will become fact.
Cool.
Yeah, and this is a way for the GM to put the narrative reins in fully into the player's hands. And mm-hmm. it's with really amazing results that I've encountered. Mm-hmm. Whenever a player chooses to use that, you're like, oh, snap.
Yeah. There we go. Yeah.
That's amazing. Monster of the Week have like a clue gathering mechanism where it puts it fully in the player's agency to say, here's a clue, and you tell me what it is, and we'll say, yes, that's a clue for it.
Yeah, I think there's something similar to that. It's very much in the, rather than asking the question, you're asking the question and then answering it.
Yeah.
But we still have the release valve that the player can ask the question of the GM if they don't want to.
Yeah. I really love having the option of putting full player agency into the scenes, especially in these Powered by the Apocalypse games where everything's a back and forth and collaborative conversation.
Yeah, definitely on the collaborative, creating your own narrative or the direction that you wanted the story to go in. Mm-hmm. There have been a lot of times when, yeah, players have, they just, oh, it's been really, I feel like, Lowell, do you want to give an example of it?
Of a study move
that's gone? Yeah, where they declared a detail. Because I think it's the narrative shift that's very important. Like, you can say, oh, I happen to have this weapon in my hand. That's not what we're talking about for this game, which is a little that I want to emphasize.
Like, I remember in the big long game, there was a section where one of the players, they did a study move, and essentially they said, I think I see the same birthmark that I have on this named agent of the villain. And I think I realized that, in fact, they are a long-lost relative of me. Oh. And they played that out, and it changed everything.
Wow.
It changed everything. And that's the kind of thing that happens in these movies, mm-hmm. and that people can do at the table.
It feels like it's one of my sort of favorite parts of, like, fate that you've mm-hmm. pulled into Powered by the Apocalypse through, like, spending fate points and having compels and things like that, mm-hmm. that doing the study move to declare these aspects yeah. reminds me a lot of that, and I love that.
Mm-hmm. I love it's interesting, as we're going over the, like, genre tropes of wuxia and whatnot, a lot of it feels like it's hitting the same sort of points as, like, Pasión de las Pasiones hits.
It yes. is. It is action melodrama like Pasión and like Worldwide Wrestling. All yeah. of those are about action, and then we go to melodrama, and then action, and then melodrama. So, mm-hmm. yeah.
I love that so much. Okay, so how do the mechanics of character creation then reinforce the feel of Hearts of Wulin? This is a little abstract of a question sometimes, but when you're picking your stats, you're picking your abilities, your moves, is there anything with that, the process of creating your characters, that reinforces how the game is supposed to feel?
I felt like I was, like, really immediately pulled in seeing the elements on the sheet and seeing, like, that it was prominently, like, fighting style
yeah.
and just the like, space that was taking up and the order that these different things drawn through. It was like, oh, it's not like the moves were, like, cool and interesting and fun, but they didn't seem nearly as important as, like, how my character interacts with the world and, like, how they are relating to the other characters and their, like, relationships to them. Mm-hmm.
The openness and fuzziness of players having to describe their own style, like, okay, you name your style and you name what weapon it is and, you know, you name the element and you kind of think about what it looks like, and we're not giving you any mechanics for that. Because I want to prime them for the fact that when we get to combat, tell me what your combat looks like. Tell mm-hmm. me what your style looks like. Because that's the only thing that matters.
Yeah.
I want them to be ready for that. And I think that part of character creation also, you go, oh, wait, there aren't any, like, fighting moves mm-hmm. In this. And I think that's something there. Agatha, do you want to talk about how the entanglements part works with that?
Yeah. I've been talking about this a lot, about the way that entanglements set tone. Because, first of all, the entanglements you choose from the list, you don't create them yourself. And so you see on the, you take inspiration from all these ones that you're going to potentially pick from, and they're all super melodramatic. So it's getting you in that mindset, and you pick it, and then that becomes your story. This is, again, with the expectation. And then mm-hmm. also it kind of puts you, and I mentioned this on the last episode a little bit, in this, the cultural values of this kind of, the people who would be in this genre as well, where they again, I mean, these are some really heightened situations, right? Like, mm-hmm. Like, my rival knows the bad actions I did to the family of my friend. You know, this, like, is not a normal situation of, like, let's say, like, ancient Chinese people. But again, it's that family is continuously at the forefront of a lot of these entanglements. Your parental figures are important, siblings are important, and because it's a lot of times it would just be family member, you can also say, like, my uncle or my aunt, right? Mm. But they are equally as important if you decide to put them into this entanglement. And I think that's brilliant, because this means that your character should care about both of these aspects, or both of the people that you've plugged into this entanglement, and again, the family is just as important as as, for example, my romantic pursuits, which is something to help people get into what it's like coming from the perspective of a more collectivist society, where it's like my clan's needs are my needs, and or my family's needs are my needs, and sometimes that means that I should not be together with someone because it simply because they are from a different family that doesn't have the same goals as mine, right? Like, so these are the kind of things that I think are great for it. And I think last episode we also talked briefly about what if people are not familiar with this genre, or they're not familiar with this cultural background and they're a little intimidated by it, maybe, which is totally fair. Then I think the entanglements actually does a lot to help people get into that kind of mode of thinking, because if you pick this, then this is a part of your motivations.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, so we already briefly touched on this when Lowell talked about the fighting style, but how does the process of character creation set a player's expectation for like playing the system?
I think one of the things is because the stats, I don't say the stat is for this, you're just kind of putting that limits on there. I think that's making clear you're going to choose what you roll. There's nothing is tightly associated with anything. So I think that portion of rules explanation gets across pretty well through that process.
And I really like how there's so much in the character creation process that is fully within your agency to describe. All the different names that you come up with, your fighting style, name and description that you come up with, all those sorts of things kind of add together to say you're going to be having more agency in this game as you're playing than you will in a lot of other games.
There's also the thing that you have to take a romantic entanglement.
Yeah.
You have to take a general, and you have to take a romantic. And I've had players come in and go, I don't want to have a romantic. I want to be a lone wolf. And I'm like, no. And I have to be the GM that says no. And I say, no, that's not what this game is about. This game is about being entangled in these things. And then they're like, oh, okay, I guess so. And then they'll pick a romantic, and then their heart gets broken, and I love it.
Yep. It's Hearts of Wulin for a reason.
Yes.
Awesome. Now, every developer's favorite question. What do you think is the biggest flaw of character creation in this system?
Ooh, that's a great question.
I have a couple thoughts.
Go for it.
So, one is, I love the entanglements. I think they're really great, but they're also very different from other things, and they require a kind of slowdown and collaboration. And because we are cross-cutting a lot of stuff, it is the place where you have to slow down and make sure that everyone's on the same page and keep track of that. And I'd say that's a friction point. I think I think the payoff is so good that I'm willing to take that cost for the potential, like, okay, we got to get that figured out. But I do think that's the part of character creation that can be challenging for players.
Yeah, I noticed when I was going through the entanglements, I was searching, and I was purposefully waiting to hear what other people were coming up with, so I could play off of something, because since it was so open-ended, there was parts of it where I thought, I'm kind of putting this agency onto somebody else. So I wanted to create something, a bond, an entanglement that played with somebody instead of, you know, putting them into a different story that they may or may not want, you know. But the amount of entanglements that you have allows you to give you that sort of flexibility, which is really nice.
I'll say the other thing that I think is actually a flaw of some other PBTA games, but especially this one. Like, so in Masks, you really know what you're doing in Masks. Like, you know your teen heroes, you know your superheroes, you've got, and the moves really hone in on that because the genre is kind of narrow. Dungeon World, same thing. You know, we know what we're doing here. Genre is pretty narrow. We know what the activity is. Because Hearts of Wulin is very broad, we're doing a lot of different things. We're doing romance, and we might be doing intrigue, and we might be doing fighting and all those things, that it means that when you're picking your playbook moves, you may not know exactly how the game is going to go. Mm-hmm. And I always feel like it's a little bit cart before the horse on that, that I almost want, that I think as an options, if you've played this for a bit, that the GM should say, pick your playbook moves as we go along. Don't pick them now. Pick them mm-hmm. as we play, because you want to have them be useful. And, you know, and that's a different look than going, okay, I want to shape my character and shape my play to what I've chosen in playbook moves. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's actually a structural thing for a lot of PBTA games that are broad, where I'm like, oh, let's choose our playbook moves later.
That's very interesting, because I always felt like when a player chooses playbooks, they're basically signaling that this is what they want for their character and this is what they want for the game. Mm-hmm. And what I do sometimes is I get them to read them all out loud again to me, especially like the triggers for them, to me and to each other, in case they can't do it themselves and they need someone to put them in that situation. Or, for example, there's one about breaking a promise. If you find out that someone else has broken their promise to you, then, you know, you get certain things to do with that. And so that one definitely needs a lot of buy-in from everyone else. So I will get them to keep reading. Oh, yeah,
you know, you're right.
Yeah.
I'm looking at it from like a purely GM perspective, but I think you're absolutely on the money that is a thing that requires the whole group to be aware of, to help lean into other people's playbook moves.
Yeah, that's depending really on it.
Yeah.
I think but kind of along that line, is this similar? I don't know.
Segway.
What a bad one. I feel like sometimes if it's not established very clearly at the beginning of the game, what kind of game this is, or if people are coming from very different backgrounds of playing, sometimes people would pick moves that they think are more tactically advantageous. And then those are they're fine moves usually, but if you only pick those, then you'll realize that your moves will not be as interesting when you play, because this is not that kind of a game where you need a lot of tactical positioning for mm-hmm. like fights or to investigate situations. So I think I guess this is just one of those things where we need to have like a GM section for people to make sure that they tell people, but I'm not sure.
Yeah. It's the move that Black Petal has about Stormrider being able to be anywhere within line of sight.
Yeah.
I've seen players who go, oh, okay, that'll be great on the battlefield. It's not for that. It's for looking cool. It's for being wherever you want and looking super awesome rather than, okay, I'm going to be able to get here so I can strike at this person. So, yeah, I think you're right about that sort of break between tactical and narrative, I think.
Yeah, and I guess that's a weakness because we don't say anywhere, at least right now, that
we need to, yeah.
Yeah, that this we need to signpost that. By the way, don't worry about tactical positioning, and also I guess this is for the GMs as well, like don't focus on that, because then your game will really struggle.
Yeah when I looked at that move, I thought more about like standing on top of rooftops and like blowing in the wind and things like that. And like it mostly sort of signaled to me when I saw that this was a move that even existed, that it's like, oh well, if this is a thing that characters can do, then obviously the sort of minutiae of these sorts of things aren't going to be something that I really need to super keep track of, because being able to do any, basically go anything, go anywhere, like fundamentally ignore a whole swath of rules if it was a tactical game, isn't necessarily a thing that most designers would put in their game, because it's like, oh, if it's tactical, you're going to want to do these tactics. And so it felt a little signally to me, like as somebody who's played a lot of different role-playing games, as somebody who's played a lot of different tactical games, and a lot of different games that are incredibly untactical, that when I saw it, it felt more like an ability that I would see in something like Nobilis, than an ability that I would see in something like Pathfinder.
Yeah, well, we're still working on our line of sight rules, of course, you know, so we'll get all that
worked
out.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
Line of sight.
Well, you need line of sight to know which of your romantic interests you can see at any time.
That's brilliant.
Awesome.
So, Hearts of Wulin uses the Powered by the Apocalypse framework. Can you tell us what it was like designing a game within this fairly established mechanical system?
That's another one for me. like, when I first played Powered by the Apocalypse, I, like, hacked a game together right away, because that's what you do. And I made up a game, and I ran it for Rich Rogers and some people, and I was very excited about it. And they were very, very generous about the play. And there were a couple of moments that where it actually sang, where Rich was like, oh, that worked. You know, I didn't realize his implication was the rest of your stuff isn't working. And then when I played other Powered by Apocalypse games with Rich and with Jason Cordova and stuff, I was like, oh, I did not get that. Mm-hmm. And I think you do have to get it. I think it's very easy to look at Powered by the Apocalypse and go, oh, yeah, it's just some moves, it's some stuff, we can figure this out, da, 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 da. You need to get it. You need to see how it's actually played. You need to see what you need to say, what you need to imply, and what you need to not say. And I think that's challenging, you know, mm-hmm. To cut and cut down to what you want. Because I cut a lot to get to where this is. And I've played Powered by Apocalypse games that I don't think the designers did that. I think they were designers, and I think they had some really good ideas, but I don't think they looked at table play like I've had to look at table play, because I run 5 times a week, mm-hmm. you know? So that's at least been it for me for Powered by the Apocalypse. What, you know, and I hear people say, oh, you know, 2 billion people hack Powered by the Apocalypse or whatever, blah, 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 blah. You know, then that, I don't think so. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't care if people are using the same system over and over again and getting good results. So.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you're making a good game, it's a good system to be making that game in.
Yeah, I heard somebody the other week refer to Powered by the Apocalypse as like indie D20. But like, there are definite benefits to having that sort of like shared assumption and shared framework that like when mm-hmm. I hear something's a Powered by the Apocalypse game, that I'm already sort of primed for certain sorts of play aspects.
Yeah, and some designs don't get. I don't want to be unpleasant. Some designs haven't gotten what's actually going on with Powered by the Apocalypse, mm-hmm. and then some designs are doing things that I'm like, oh my gosh, how did we get to here? This is wonderful. Like Legacy Life Among the Ruins. I think that what Jay Isles has done with that is amazing, and I never would have occurred to me. And there's so many cool things going on in there. And I love that. Let me start over again. Yeah, it's Powered by the Apocalypse, but she's gone in a different direction with that. So, and done something completely new.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one of the things I love about Powered by the Apocalypse that I'm seeing a lot nowadays is the strength it has in emulating certain genres. And like, this is a very specific sort of genre style game, and it feels like it would emulate it very well. Then you have Pasión de las Pasiones, very good telenovela simulator, I guess you could call it. Then there's the Worldwide Wrestling, which does like amazing stuff with simulating actual in front of the scenes and behind the scenes professional wrestling. And the list just goes on and on and on. And it's all Powered by the Apocalypse. You can do this in other systems, but it's interesting that most of the things that I want to emulate this genre really sing in Powered by the Apocalypse.
Yeah, I think where you have a very strong sense of what a genre is and what's involved with it, Powered by the Apocalypse lets you get at those points more easily than maybe other systems might. Mm-hmm. Like, I love Fate, but Fate is also... It has implied competency for the characters and certain things like that that are, mm-hmm. are baked in that you have to change a lot of the dials to move out of. Mm-hmm. But by the same token, yeah, Powered by the Apocalypse, there are certain genres I wouldn't do necessarily. I wouldn't be my first go-to for it.
Right, exactly.
Okay. Agatha, do you want to say anything? Because I've just been talking like a white dude way too much here. So
No, I wanted to know what genre you wouldn't do Powered by the Apocalypse in.
I wouldn't do something that where failure was not a thing. where we are all about, you know, characters win, but we have to decide what the cost is. I don't think I'd do swashbucklers with Powered by the Apocalypse. That kind of happy-go-lucky thing. I don't think I would do that.
Okay.
That'd be one that I could think of.
Yeah, a Pirates of the Caribbean sort of style swashbuckler thing feels much more like Fate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I wouldn't do anything like Tachyon Squadron or anything with like space combat or ship combat or tactical stuff. Those are not things I would do necessarily with Powered by the Apocalypse.
Interesting.
Yeah, I think once you introduce like strategic combat in any form, I don't think PBTA really hits that well because it's supposed to be a conversation.
Oh, that's very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So, my co-host Daniel Kwan is writing Ross Rifles, and it's pretty much done, which is a game about World War One.
Oh, yes.
Ooh, close call. and there's a lot of tactical elements to it. I mean, again, not like it's not fully mimetic, but I think that's actually a very interesting observation.
Well, I think the tactics of World War One can work for something Powered by the Apocalypse because like trenches and things like that, that a lot of it is about like these sort of like sweeping, like conversationally sort of things about like the different sides and like how are you reacting to the conflict.
Yeah, the Watch has, you know, it has that process, but as you say, that's kind of all the narrative thing of going out to the field and we do the battlefield stuff, and that's abstracted, and then it's more important about what happens when we come back.
Mm-hmm. And when I think when I'm thinking tactics, I'm thinking you draw out the battle map, you draw out how many hexes you are from each other, and you know, old school wargaming D&D style games, which is, you know, perfectly valid of a play style for a lot of people, doesn't seem to sing too well. It seems like you would be blending a Powered by the Apocalypse game and a combat simulator that's not Powered by the Apocalypse.
Right.
I'll tell you another thing that for me, if I were to try to hack it, I wouldn't start with Powered by the Apocalypse, is something like Ars Magica or Mage the Ascension, which relies on these wonderful granularities of combinations and details and resource management that's half the game is figuring out how I combine these things and get these routes together and do all that kind of thing that I are important to the feel of the game.
Yeah.
But aren't what I want to do in PBTA.
Interesting. All right. Well, how about the setting for this game? Were there particular themes that you wanted to work with, or ideas that you wanted to incorporate into this game?
So again, like Lowell mentioned before, the inspiration for this game is a lot of the wuxia TV shows, which are, they used to be around 40 episodes long, and now they are 60 episodes long because they are being sold by the episode. So the more episodes, the more money you make as a production company. And what are we trying to evoke? Aside from the high melodrama, I think there's certain themes that we like to evoke and which are implied in the moves, which are, there's a lot of, I feel like sometimes the wuxia genre is I don't want to say purer or sweeter, but in my mind I like to compare this game to Monster Hearts, which is a lot more about kids being savage with each other and themselves. And this game is more, a lot of times the struggle is from external forces. Yes, you're having inner conflicts, but it's about external situations that place people who mean to do good, or maybe not, but have things that they care about, and then they have to decide between them. So I think that a lot of times ends up what happens in this game. Would you say that's true, Lowell?
Yeah, and it's something that you pointed out to me related to that is we have PvP as a move. in this game. Mm-hmm. And it's a separate game. We assume that all players are on the same scale. That's yes. just bottom line. I've had some GMs ask, well, how can a player get to better scale up on another player? I go, they can't. That's not how that works. Mm-hmm. It dramatically, you're all on the same scale because you're all PCs. Mm-hmm. When you get into like a legit conflict with another player, not like manipulating them or something, but where like you are wanting to do something or you want to fight them, then we go to a PvT move. And what it is you say, if you let me win this fight, the challenger says this to the challengee, if you let me win this fight, I will give you these things. I'll give you my XP. I'll mark a bunch of my elements. I'll give you narrative control of how this all looks. I'll change my entanglement so I'm no longer in love with the person who loves you. Or I'll change myself so now I love you. All these things. You make one offer, and the other player has to decide whether they accept that offer and let you win, or they say no, in which case, if they say no, then you both mark an element. And the person who's challenged says, okay, I think it's a draw, or I think I win. Mm. And it means that when you go to that PvP, you've got to stop and slow down and think about it. And there's a risk reward. And I was super nervous about this move. Like, I was super nervous about it. But boy, has it been fun at the table. It's been great. The climax of the 13 session game we did ended with a PvP move, and the challenger convinced the challengee to let them kill them. It was great.
Oh wow!
It was really great.
Yeah. So I think again, the themes that are associated with the wuxia genre are ideas of justice and ideas of like, what does it mean to be just? What does it, and like power? And these are things that are constantly explored in these stories. Who gets to have power, and why do they say they want it, and why do they really want it? And what is righteousness? And because there's a lot of stuff that has to do with reputation in these stories. So, and we kind of have that with the factions. The factions, they all have an associated reputation tag, if you will, so they can be righteous or unrighteous, or they can be destroyed. So that's their rep. Gone. But it's that so there's a lot of these kind of ideas, like, and who are people on the surface versus who are they on the inside? And this sometimes manifests literally in terms of people with multiple hidden identities, which is always a headache for the GM to keep track of, but it's very fun. And so I think these are some of the themes, and then tonally it's definitely heightened. But how I like to describe it is that the PCs or the characters in this story take themselves very seriously. That doesn't mean that we as players necessarily have to, but when you're playing them, they do. Mm-hmm. And I think that explains like melodrama pretty well. So like, ridiculous things happen, but you're like, oh, I'm legit really upset that you took off your scarf and now suddenly you're not the person that I thought you were because you look like a completely different actor. And instead of being like, this ridiculous, I'm like, but I thought you were my friend and now you're my enemy, and so on and so forth, right? So that's the kind of tone you want to evoke, and then that we want a kind of player buy-in into, and then also themes, like just a lot of like the traditional Confucius themes of like filial piety, loyalty, who are you loyal to, and how much are you willing to sacrifice to maintain that part of yourself, because loyalty is not just a virtue, but it is a value, right? Mm-hmm. Like, this is how you view yourself, is that I am a loyal person. And so, I mean, I don't know how much this actually gets explored in various games, but this is what I hope for, because these are the kind of things that are explored in these stories.
Nice.
Yeah, so let's sort of pull in a little bit and talk about the group of characters that we just made. And they're like cohesion. How do we feel the current group gels together, like mechanically? Would this group like do interesting things and fare well in a typical session in this system, do you think?
Oh, yeah. And right away, I want to know how it's going to get revealed to like Perfected Fist that set my character 7th century Zhu, did horrible things and killed who Zhu thinks was Perfected Fist's father. Like, I am all in for that right away. That's that's the gel. All those entanglements, they are the glue that binds us together, because I want answers, and I want them now.
Yeah. I think they'll definitely work. The entanglements, they just kind of, they run the game. And it, does everyone have, like, a particular scene that they would love to see from, like, for their characters or for any characters? Because I know that for Xiang Hui, my character, I think the scene that I would definitely try to signal to the GM is I want a scene with Xiang Hui and Crystal Willow, his sister, because I'm very curious. Like, I've established in my mind that he loves her, that he loves his sister very much, because he loves everyone until proven otherwise. And then to have this conversation, like, oh, like, you're married to such an awesome person. This is a great place for, like, you know, inner conflict, because married to the man that he loves. And but then also, like, but also what is going on with this marriage? Because he don't seem very loyal.
Yeah.
So that's the scene. And that's the
one. Yeah, that's the one where the fail and the inner conflict would have your sister going, I love him so much. He's the best. He means everything in the world to me. I don't know what I would do if someone were to cause problems in that relationship. That would be the fail state on that particular move.
That's really good.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to remember that for next time.
Yeah, I think if I think about, like, a scene that I want to see with, like, Black Petal, is I think about just, like, dealing with Black Petal and It Petal's Dancer and, like, that conflict there, about, like, sort of, like, struggling with the concept of, like, falling out of love with someone and dramatic makeouts.
Yeah. And someone who potentially doesn't want to let go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And maybe you get pulled back in.
Mm-hmm. I want to see the scene where it's revealed that Zhu had something to do with my supposed father's death. And because of that, I ran back to Jade Serpent for comfort. And that's when they told me that wasn't my real father.
Oof, yes.
And I don't know who my real father is.
Wow.
I would love to see that.
Yeah. Nice.
So I think with this, it's this means that, yes, that our characters will definitely gel very well in a session, even if some of these are more aimed towards NPCs, but because they will tie back to each other, and who knows who may fail a move at some point. That means that other NPCs will for sure get tied in and more revelations will happen.
Yeah.
I also like that, looking at the elements and the spread for, like, our characters, that each one of us, like, across the four of us, somebody has a +2 in any of the in each of the elements.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's nice. Yeah.
That's interesting.
It doesn't always happen. That's nice.
Yeah, the only duplicates we have are earth and fire.
True. And we're the strongest collectively with wood, because nobody has a -1 in wood.
Yeah.
That's so great.
Which I wouldn't have expected, thinking about these characters.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
I chose +2 for wood because Xiang Hui is very curious.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I assume we'll have to have some growth.
Yeah, I chose +2 for wood for Black Petal because of patience. And because while she, like, is a person who's sort of, like, happy with where she is, I think she should change.
Interesting.
Nice.
Yeah, and I chose +2 for fire because, obviously, just his explosive personality and his passion for his abilities and whatnot. But then I chose +2 in earth because fire exploding earth is kind of his whole thing. Smoldering crater in the earth.
Yeah.
But the focus, I think, and the presence of Earth is kind of what he embodies. You know, he's got that unflinching confidence, even when going against a foe that probably he shouldn't. He just walks right up to him.
Yeah, I was tempted to put a +2 in Earth as well, and I ended up putting it in Metal, because, like, I didn't really want to play a character who was cautious. I wanted to still play somebody who, like, took their time a lot, but who necessarily didn't always, like, was like, oh, well, that's just an acceptable amount of risk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and so, like, the calculation aspect of Metal stood out to me.
Yeah, that's really cool. I love these characters.
Yeah, I actually, yeah. Now that you, Ryan, now that you've said more about Perfective Fist, all I want to see is, like, is for Perfective Fist to get slammed with inner conflict. And I want to see what that looks like. This uh-huh. person who, like, I want to see this, like, bravado, like, I don't know, crack. And then, like, see the person underneath and what he cares about.
Mm-hmm.
And what he doesn't want yeah. people to see. Oh. Yeah.
Yes, what's behind his swagger.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And I love that one of my agendas is conceal your truth.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So, like, this whole outside exterior confidence is pretty much an act to fool everybody else of what's actually happening inside.
That's great.
I like it.
And does he fool himself, Ethan?
Oh,
nice.
I love these people so much.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll play this.
Uh-huh.
I know I really like characters when I look at this and I go, man, I want horrible things to happen.
Oh,
to them.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
You just want all of them to, like, fall dramatically on their knees in the rain.
Yep. Yep.
As
yep,
like blood yeah. and rainwater pours down their face, but oh maybe it's God. Tears.
I want to now. I want to see a scene where we're in the rain and my character's suffering, and I punch the ground and just create yeah. a bigger and bigger crater.
I will tell you, when Agatha ran for me the first time I actually played as a player last time, I literally, when we got to the final scene and Agatha did her hard move on me, I literally shouted out, "No!" Like, I couldn't control myself, and I had a tear run down my cheek. I was broken.
Oh, man.
She absolutely did me in, didn't see it coming, and it was great.
Yeah.
Nice.
I didn't see the tear because we were playing online. And
yes.
And I was like,
I'm okay.
Awesome.
Yeah. So with this game, I think it doesn't matter what kind of characters you create. They generally, if all the players are on the same page in terms of what kind of tone they want to play with, then they will always gel.
That's awesome. So let's talk about the system as a whole then. What do you think about how it plays and how it lends to character development, not character advancement, but like how can people grow within the narrative of this game?
I think that's, like, immediately apparent, because yeah. what we were just talking about, like, was all about character growth and character change, and, like, there's just, like, very quick priming of all of those different arcs in there.
And this is something that Agatha, like, mentioned to me early on when she ran that players had a question about, and that I ended up rewriting the rules, is start a session. We look at your entanglements. It used to be just to talk about your entanglements and highlight them. But now we go, where are your entanglements right now? Do we need to rewrite them? Do we need to change them? Do we need to adjust them? And they ought to be. Every session, we stop at the first thing and we say, are those still where you are? Or has somebody died?
Mm.
Has something changed? And you rewrite them if you need to. And we do that check in every session.
I love that.
That's helped.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because that's like on your character sheet then. Mm-hmm. It's not just a story beat. It's a, I'm accepting this character's change, and now I'm going to commit it to my actual character sheet, which yes. kind of, it has that extra, like, gravitas to it, I think, that feels more permanent, I guess you could say, until, obviously, the next session.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, you also said that, like, advancement and things like that, that you get more, like, experience and stuff out of doing the highlighted entanglement. Mm-hmm. That that also like really like pushes the character towards like engaging with that entanglement, and that probably means that entanglement's going to change.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, and I was going to say something, now I forgot. entanglements, they change. Nah, it's gone.
Sorry.
It's all right.
Yeah, like some other PPTA games. I mean, I love like the relationship questions, like in Masks and things like that, but those are very static at the start. They establish some baseline, and then you move away from that. We never go back to relook at them. These are dynamic, changing assets to your character.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I do remember now. So I think one aspect of entanglements and continuously giving people the option to change them also implies that, or I would say that it creates a sort of implied honesty in the player in terms of how they see their characters. And I think this is sometimes to counteract people who have a tendency to power game. And I don't mean statistically power gaming, because that's just not very possible in this game, but in more like narratively power gaming, which is that, again, like what Lowell was saying before, people saying, I don't want to my character to have romantic entanglement because I don't want my character to be beholden to someone else in that way, you know, and to have that power imbalance. So sometimes people would be like, oh yeah, like my entanglement is that I'm in love with them, but then when they play it, it's just not like that at all, or like I feel this way, or I care about the opinion of this person. But when they play it, they just keep dismissing this character, or what they're saying and stuff. So then next time, then the GM or other players can be like, so like last time you don't seem to say that. So is that even true for your entanglement? Mm-hmm. And then generally, if they double down, and then it's like, okay, then you've made that statement. You have to now really roleplay to that. Mm-hmm. Or if they're like, okay, maybe not, then they change to something, and the next time they do, or whatever they change to, then they will actually commit to it more, in my experience, at least.
That makes sense.
Cool. So, sounds like we're ready to move on a little bit and get into our advancement discussion segment, and take it up a level.
Take it up a level. Take it up a level.
All right, so in this segment, we will cover how character advancement, or leveling up, is covered in the system. So how does a character level up in Hearts of Wulin? And what sort of perks are we looking at when that happens?
All right, Lowell. I can talk about how you can get experience. So yes, we do have experience points in this game. Right now, it's out of 8 per level. And I mentioned before that you can get experience from hitting your entanglements during session. So there's, again, the highlighted and the non-highlighted one. Highlighted, if you hit on it, there's three experience points. And then the non-highlighted one, you get 1 experience point. And also, when you're in-game, when you roll inner conflict, you also automatically get 1 experience out of that.
Cool. Yeah, we've kind of added onto that. We've got that, and we also, if you fail your inner conflict roll, that's the only time you get XP on a miss is for inner conflict.
Oh, so, interesting.
It is pushing you to go for those inner conflict rolls.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I think one of my character's moves gave me experience just for triggering the move.
Oh yeah.
Which is really cool.
Yeah. There's some things. There's the classic. If you let me convince you to do something, you get an XP, which is standard. And also, if you show mercy in combat when you win, you get XP.
Oh, cool.
Hmm. Yeah.
So what happens when you have 8 XP? Like, what do you get?
We've got a very simple set of advancements. It is. I don't like have any kind of. At least right now, we don't have after 5. You get these super cool things. Mm-hmm. At least where it stands right now is, you can for an advance. You can take 1 advance on each of your elements to raise it by 1. You can do each of those once. You can take up to, I think, 3 more moves from your own playbook. You can take up to 2 more moves from other people's playbooks.
Oh, cool.
But not roll moves. We keep those unique. And then as another option, if you want to, you can make up a custom move for your style. And I've seen some people use that. That's one that we're still kind of tweaking, but like in the game we play with Jean Hu Hustle, co-hosts, I think it was Eli, had a staff character, and he wanted a character who could deal with more groups of troops at the same time so that he could move around, so that he came up with a custom move for his character, which gave him the benefit of being able to deal with more groups at once. And I've seen some other people use it. But it's easier for people to go, I want this move, or I want this raise.
That's cool. So then would it be beneficial to have advancement in mind during character creation if you're going for something specific?
I don't think so. I honestly don't. Advancement is fun, but okay, I'm going to tell you the dirty secret that Agatha revealed to me when we were talking about the game. She was like, you know what? Sometimes people go for their playbook moves, but more often they are just we are just running off the basic moves.
Yeah.
It is very easy for you to play and have fun and get by and then go, oh yeah, you know, I've got these playbook moves. They're cool. But you can, we will get rolling and just have a great time. Just on the basic moves. The playbook moves are awesome, but they are icing on top of the cake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So most games out there, especially PBTA games, you're generally playing to figure out where you're going with your character.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to plot out, I need this by the time I get to this level so I can take this other cool thing.
Yes.
Which is really nice when you're trying to just play I don't want to say casual game, mm-hmm. but a game that's not so crunchy.
Yeah, I think the only exception to that in PBTA that I've ever seen is the mortal in Monster Hearts, that a lot of like the mortal is about like one of the ways you can definitely play that playbook is by leveraging its ability to take lots of moves from other playbooks,
mm-hmm.
and having the sort of story of the character be about like discovering or becoming more monstrous with that game's definition of monster.
Yeah.
It's fun though to just sort of go, my character is going to go places. Mm-hmm. Let's roll.
I can definitely see in gameplay for this game, as you're getting closer and closer to that level up and you know you're going to be taking a move or something, that you'll start thinking about like, well, what's my character been doing and what sort of cool moves enhances that experience that this character is working with in the game.
Yes.
So I can see that, but definitely not during character creation.
Right.
Cool. I think that's it. I think we talked about your game.
That is awesome. I love these characters too.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, this has been so much fun. Agatha and Lowell, thank you both so much for joining us to talk about Hearts of Wulin and doing character creation with us. Lowell, could you go ahead and remind everyone where they can find you and what sort of cool things you're working on?
I'm part of the Gauntlet gaming community. I can be found there. You can find me on Twitter at EDIGE23. Also, if you're interested in actual play videos of Hearts of Wulin and like 100 other games, you can check out my YouTube channel and see lots and lots of actual plays. Like this month, it's all Tales from the Loop and Thanks from the Flood and all kinds of good stuff. So I record 3 games a week.
Nice.
So that's up there.
Awesome. And Agatha, how about yourself?
I am the co-host again of Asians Represent. So basically, any way to get in contact with me is through social media of Asians Represent. That's at AZNS Represent on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. And you can also email us at AZNSRepresent@oneshotpodcast.com. I am also working, I'm going to be contributing to the One Child's Heart Kickstarter. I'm writing a scenario, if you will, maybe a child, I believe is how that works. It sounds really weird. I wouldn't put it that way. So yeah, you can go check it. I don't know if the Kickstarter will still be going on when this episode goes up, but it's a cool game. So regardless, you should check it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Camden put together something really kind of special there. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how that all pans out.
Yeah. And our Kickstarter, our target date right now is May 7th. That may or may, that's probably, if it's on, you can go and check us on Kickstarter. We will have available some kind of play packet for players. We have a preliminary playtest packet right now that has like fully complete, you can run from, no problem. And we're going to be working that to a quick start version as well.
Very cool. Yeah, and we will have links in the show notes to all of that in case you want to get to it fairly easily. So thank you both again for joining mm-hmm. us. And thank you to everybody that is listening right now. We will see you again next week for our next Character Evolution Cast episode. Character Creation Cast is a production of the One Shot Podcast Network and can be found online at www.charactercreationcast.com. Head to the website to get more information on our hosts and guests, or even some of our character sheets. Character Creation Cast can be found on Twitter at @creationcast. I'm one of your hosts, Ryan Bolter, and I can be found on Twitter at Lord Neptune. Our other host, Amelia Antrim, can be found on Twitter at Ginger Reckoning. Music for this episode is used with a Creative Commons license or with permission from the podcast they originated from. Further information can be found within the show notes. Our main theme music is Hero Remix by Steve Combs and is used with a Creative Commons license. This podcast is owned by us under Creative Commons. This episode was edited by Ryan Bolter. Further information for the game systems used and today's guests can also be found in the show notes. If you like the systems discussed and wish to purchase them, links to the product can be found in the show notes. Also, check the notes or the website for cool stuff to go with each character, such as dice or mixtapes. Thanks for joining us, and remember, we find that the best part of any role-playing game is character creation. So go out there and create some amazing people. We will see you next time.
Read some show blurbs.
Show blurbs.
Show blurbs.
Show blurbs.
Show blurbs. Character Creation Cast is hosted by the One Shot Podcast Network. If you enjoyed our show, visit oneshotpodcast.com, where you'll find other great shows like System Mastery.
System Mastery is a delightful stroll through the history of role-playing games, except the games are terrible, and the hosts are real jerks about everything. Join hosts Jeff and John as they explore the weirdest games ever made to talk about what worked, what went wrong, and which Silverhawk was the best. It was Hot Wing, don't even at us. Find their shows at SystemMasteryPodcast.com or OneShotPodcast.com.
Finally,